Our text today is from the Old Testament reading. And David said unto him, Mephibosheth, fear not, for I will surely show thee kindness for Jonathan thy father's sake. Mephibosheth was 5 years old when the tragic news came to the palace in Gibeah. The Philistines had crushed the armies of Israel. And on a single day, the 5-year-old boy lost his grandfather, King Saul, lost his father, Prince Jonathan, lost his uncle on the slopes of Mount Gilboa. The Philistines were ruthless. They mutilated the dead bodies of Saul and his sons, and then hung them high on the walls of Bashan and let them swing there in the wind. They would not show mercy to any of the surviving members of Saul's household. And there was something else here, too. David and his band of 600 warriors were out there somewhere on the loose. Saul had chased David out of the country. For years, hunted him down as an animal. And now that Saul's out of the picture, Jonathan's out of the picture, there's nothing to stop David from coming back and cleaning the house and taking vengeance on the house of Saul that had made his life miserable. They didn't know what to do with the palace, the family members and the servants. So they panicked and ran for their lives. A nurse grabbed up the 5-year-old boy, Mephibosheth, and fled into the night. I don't know what she tripped over, but she stumbled and fell with the little boy in her arms. And in the fall, his ankles were broken. Both ankles. He was carried by the fugitive down across the Jordan River Valley. On and on they pressed to the far eastern frontier, to a lonely, windswept village of Lodabar on the edge of no man's land. But the bones never knit. The little boy was never able to walk well. Mephibosheth was a cripple all his life. He was also the last surviving heir of the house of Saul. And if word of that got out, they figured, his life would be in danger. So they concealed the boy's ancestry. They concealed his identity. They stole away his future. Mephibosheth wasn't to blame for any of it. He was only 5 years old when his family, his father, were lost in battle, and the tragic flight ended in a debilitating accident. Mephibosheth was, in today's terminology, a victim. If you've ever lived in a small town, you know how the locals preserve their identity. Oh, man, they remember the old days, the bad and the good. And they pass those stories along from generation to generation. So it's easy to imagine the little boy sitting around the evening campfires at Lodabar and listening to those stories. I'm guessing that his nurse, oh, with sadness in her voice, was the chief storyteller, how they had both become victims. And I'm guessing, but I bet you the name of David came up a lot in those stories. David is the man to whom we must blame. If it wasn't for David, we wouldn't have been running that night. There wouldn't have been an accident that night. If it weren't for David, we'd be living in Jerusalem right now instead of this God-forsaken village on the edge of nowhere. So, from 5 years of age, Mephibosheth is taught that everything is someone else's fault, and that someone has the face of David. Well, the long and weary years pass by in Lodabar. Mephibosheth grows up, still crippled, but worse. He's crippled in spirit by all the embittering stories he has been told. He's become what his name means, the dishonored one. That wasn't his real name. His given name was Meribaal. But they gave him a nickname to call attention to his crippled life. Mephibosheth. And one day, a royal armed escort shows up in that little village. They're looking for Mephibosheth. And they find him. It must have been a terrifying moment. Evidently, David had been searching up and down and back and forth till he finally found somebody from Saul's house, a rival to his throne. They put him on a donkey and led him away in every step, brought him nearer to his doom. All his life, Mephibosheth had been a victim, and now it looked like the story was going to end the same way. When they ushered Mephibosheth into the king's presence, man, he expected the worst. He expected the worst because all his life he'd been told the worst. The boy had been so beaten down, so thoroughly, he couldn't look anybody in the eye anymore, especially not King David. He groveled on the ground. He called himself a dead dog. And on seeing the young man's terror, David said, Mephibosheth, fear not. Hey, relax. It's going to be all right. What Mephibosheth did not know, and what he couldn't imagine in his wildest dreams, was that he was there to be loved. Mephibosheth also did not know that his father Jonathan and David were not only the two bravest men in Israel, they were also the two best friends. They protected each other, encouraged each other, guarded each other's back. And the last time on earth that they met, Jonathan going back to the army as a soldier, David running into the wilderness for his life, they vowed a vow that if the worst happened, and they expected it would, that they would go right on loving each other by taking care of the other's family. What Mephibosheth did not know, that he was a member of that family that David vowed to love. Mephibosheth hadn't expected that. He hadn't been loved like that, at least not for a long, long time. David's first word to him is his name, without a trace of contempt to put down. Not a boy has a name. And David uses it. Mephibosheth, he's not some nameless refugee or exile. You can't love people in general. And you can't love by category. You can only love somebody who has a name and whose name you know. Mephibosheth. Haven't you ever noticed how intimately and personally Jesus dealt with people by name? Martha, Martha, you fuss and worry about so many things. One thing you see, Simon, Simon, I have prayed for thee that thy faith fail not. Zacchaeus, come on down out of that tree. I want to spend a day at your house. In the cemetery at Bethany. Lazarus, not everybody. Lazarus, come forth. And in Joseph's garden on Easter morn, the dawn of recognition first came to the Magdalene when she heard her name on his lips. Why are you crying, Mary? Jesus never deals with us anonymously, always by name. He calls us friends, brothers, sisters, children of God, but he always gives us a name. I have redeemed thee. I have called thee by thy name. Thou art mine, you and you and you, Fred and Sally and Susan and Johnny. David says to Mephibosheth, don't be afraid. Well, the fact of the matter is, there is much in this world to be afraid of. But you will find that phrase repeatedly in the Bible, on the lips of the angels, God's messengers, but especially on the lips of Jesus as he brings to his heavenly Father the broken and the confused and the outcasts of life. He said it that night in the storm at sea. Hey, be of good cheer, it is I. Don't be afraid. He said it to Jairus at that staggering moment that his daughter died. Don't be afraid. Only believe. He said it to the 12 at the last time. Don't be afraid. I'm going to prepare a place for you. He said it three times in a famous sermon. Not one sparrow goes to the ground without your Father's permission. Fear not, therefore, for you are worth more than many sparrows. And he put content into that love. David restored to Mephibosheth all the lands of his grandfather Saul. He put Ziba, Saul's old servant, in charge of running the farm and taking care of affairs. He invited Mephibosheth into his household as a member of the family. And then he set a place for him at his table every single day. Now, I've never been to a dinner party in a palace, but I can picture it. The sumptuous food spread out on the banquet tables in the great hall. The dinner bell calling the family and guests. In comes King David sitting down over there at the head of the table. Beside him, the beautiful woman, his wife, Abigail. Yeah, and here come the kids. Absalom, tremendously, and the lovely young woman, Tamar. And over there sitting Joab, the commander-in-chief of the military. And over here, David's personal bodyguard, the highly decorated soldier, Abishai. And then you hear,
clump, clump, clump.
Here comes Mephibosheth, plodding along. He smiles, sits down as a member of the family. That is a perfect picture of a vow Jesus once made to your father and my father, that he would take care of the children, protecting them, helping them, saving them. In that great line from the gospel, he would love his own in the world, and having loved them, he would love them to the end. Thank you, Son of David, for finding me when I wasn't looking, and loving me when I didn't deserve it, and bringing me into the family when I didn't belong, and preparing for me a place at your table every day of my life. Amen. The peace of God which passeth all understanding shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen.